one point at maximum amplitude, you still get that stress. And so then you have yield 220 divided by 80.55. And that one is 2.73. Is this clear to everyone? Right? So we take our combined loading state, calculate the stress components individually, combine those stress components into an equivalent normal stress, which we then compare to our endurance limit. If this were to be a design calculation, not a verification calculation, then say the diameter would have been the unknown, and then you calculate your stress components, and the diameter would be an unknown, so this would be some value as a function of d to the power 3, right, for both sigma a and tau a. You'd still go through and combine them, and you'd find an equivalent stress that is a function of d. And then your safety factor, your design factor, would be a known value if you do a design calculation. And on the right-hand side here, you would have a ratio between sigma e and sigma a prime, which is a function of d, the parameter that you're designing for, and that would be the only unknown, right? So then you solve for d. So the design calculation goes exactly the same way than the verification calculation. You only have to drag a parameter throughout your entire calculation. And if you were to have to do a design calculation, then you also could not calculate KB, so you'd have to make an assumption here, probably 0.85, and then at the end go back and check. What if we were to add a dynamic axial load over here to the shaft? How would that change our solution? So let's do this. P is 1,000 sinus omega t. Okay, so how would that change the solution? Well, first of all, you'd get an extra. Is that going to create a normal stress or a shear stress?
Normal
stress. Okay, so you get another sigma a here, right? So you get axial loading. Another sigma a component, which is going to be p divided by a. We're not going to calculate it, we'll just do it conceptually. So you get a second axial component. That means that you have now two sigma a components. They're pointing in the same direction where the stress is going to be maximum, right? Because here, in the top fibers, you're going to get compression. At the bottom fibers, you're going to get tension. So at the top fibers, they're going to counteract each other. So failure is likely going to occur at the bottom fibers here. Although it's a rotating shaft, so it's not really well defined, but it will occur here in the tension region. In the tension region, the normal stress resulting from axial loading will be superimposed and adding up with the normal stress resulting from bending. So we're going to have to rewrite this equation a little bit, and we're going to say sigma a prime is sigma a resulting from bending plus, I'm not going to translate anything here, it's not good. Let me just write it out here. Alright, so this is when the green force has been included. Okay, so sigma a prime is going to be sigma a resulting from bending plus, because we superimpose, sigma a resulting from the axial load, that's going to be squared plus 3 times tau a squared, and that entire thing is going to be raised to the power 1/2. So that's our Lemniscus criterion right now. Are we done? Is this all we need to do? There's a subtlety here, right? If you look at your formula sheet, and you look at your KC factor. You see, we said if you have pure bending, pure axial loading, pure torsion, you have these factors for KC. This is a combined loading case, so that doesn't apply. However, what we take away from that is that a dynamic axial load is more damaging to your shaft than a dynamic bending load. And so we still have to reflect that into our calculations. And the way we do that, the shear stress, by the way, we already take care of with the 3 here, right? So we don't have to take care of it anymore. But what we do here is we divide this by 0.85. And so we artificially make the axial components a little bit more important in that equation. And we're going to slightly increase sigma mu prime as a result of that, because this 0.85 is going to increase this fraction, right? And again, why do we do that? Physically, a dynamic load, a dynamic axial load, does more fatigue damage to your shaft than a bending load. So that's what needs to be reflected there. Is that clear to everyone? Yeah?
Why
does it do that? Well, I mean, that has to see with the material science and everything that is part of the material properties of the material. But essentially, it boils down to this. If you were to set up a test, and you have a pure axial, dynamic axial load on the same shaft, or on one shaft, you take the second shaft, and you have a dynamic bending load, the one that undergoes dynamic axial loading is going to fail before the one in bending. That's what that reflects. So all of this is related to empirical data. And I'm not quite sure that people have figured out exactly what the physical mechanisms are that cause that to be the case. Maybe, I just am not aware of it. But again, all of this is based on empirical data, and what this says is an axial dynamic load is going to create failure in the same shaft faster than a dynamic bending. Who was first?
So why don't we use 0.59 for the torsion if we use 0.5 fractions?
If you take 0.59, square it, and do it to the power of minus 1, and you'll find a number that is very close to 3. Oh, wow. It's already taken care of here. Okay. I think it's something like 2.87 or something, if I remember correctly. But it's already taken care of. So if you were to divide this by 0.59, you're over-accounting for your shear stresses. So you'd be way too conservative. I lost track of the order here, so there were questions here, there.
Quick question. So that 0.85, that's your Kc value. Are we just accounting for it in our sigma A prime calculation as opposed to when we would normally find sigma endurance, sigma E?
That's a good question. Why are we accounting for the axial loading here and not just here? By taking Kc equal to 0.85. Well, if we do this, then we're essentially applying this factor 0.85 to all our loading components, and that would be inaccurate. We'd be penalizing essentially too hard, right? Because if you do Kc equal to 0.85, that goes into your calculation of sigma E, and sigma E gets compared to your equivalent normal stress right here. So you're essentially applying it to all of your loading components. And the difference that we do is we pick exactly the component that we want to apply to 0.85 to it, so we're doing a way more accurate calculation. Okay?
Yes? So we have that force, the vertical force that we have, that's just like constant down, right?
So the transverse static load, yes, but the shaft is rotating.
Well, are we assuming that it's that force is also varying as with sine omega t?
No. This is a constant load, and this is this situation. This is your shaft. This is rotating, and this is just pushing on it.
Right.
And that causes an alternating stress in your shaft.
Okay. My question is, like, I feel like the amount with which it would rotate would depend on, like, the actual rotational energy of the shaft itself. And so, like, for example, if you had a really massive shaft sort of thing, then it wouldn't rotate very much. It would be almost more like a static load than a...
No. So imagine this is sort of thing. Let's listen to the question. Maybe you can learn something from it too. Right? So what you're saying essentially is this torque large enough to make the shaft spin? And I'm telling you, yes, the torque that I apply is large enough to make the shaft spin. Okay. So the shaft is going to be spinning, it's driving some inertia, which we didn't draw, and that inertia is smaller than the energy that you put in to make it spin. So you can assume that it's spinning. And maybe I could have done that explicitly by saying all right, you know, this has a certain rotational speed in one direction.
Okay. So then sort of like the inverse of that question, if it was you know, very small rotational energy, so that, like, so our torque moment, that's varying with sine omega t. So, like, you know, for a certain amount of time, it's going to be rotating in one direction at you know, a varying speed, then in the other direction, a varying speed. But it just seems like that the 2000, like, they would vary with the same rate. You know what I mean?
That 2000 doesn't vary. 2000 is constant.
Right, right. But, like, there's sort of like an effective sort of variance in the shaft.
But it's not because your torque is sinusoidal that your shaft is rotating necessarily back and forth in one direction. In this case, I didn't give you all the information. I just took this piece out of a machine and I say this is rotating in one direction and you still got a sinusoidal torque. Think about your car, combustion engine. You got a non-constant torque because you got your pistons firing, so, but it's still, the crankshaft is still rotating in one direction.
Okay.
So this is something similar here, right? And you're right in the sense that I could have given you more context, but I just want to focus on this, and I say it's rotating in one direction, but in addition, we have this core component that we're taking into account. Yes?
So if your axial load is not varying as a sinusoidal, you still apply it that
way? No, because this is only for dynamic loading, and if it's a constant load, then it would be a steady load, and we would do a whole different calculation, which we're going to get to. Okay? In the back first. No, you.
So I'm a little confused about our equivalent stress still. We would be using that 1 plus sigma a squared plus sigma shear times shear squared for static stress, right?
Right.
So 3 would still be there for static stress. So I'm wondering why we're using the same formula for static and alternating stress.
So this is a problem where we only have alternating components, because this is a fatigue failure problem where we're only dealing with alternating components. When we deal with alternating and steady components together, we're going to have to use different failure criteria, which is the next topic we're going to get to. But for now, why would you be able for an alternating component to use phlogistons? It's just a normal stress. It changes in time, but you could perfectly use it for alternating components too. The thing you cannot do is mix steady components with alternating components. You need to keep those separate, and we'll talk about that. But
I guess my question is really about scaling factor. So you said earlier that we don't scale the torsion by AC because of the 3 accounting for the scaling already.
Uh-huh.
But I'm just wondering why that 3 is then there for non-alternating loads. Does that make sense?
Why the 3 is there for non-alternating loads? I'm not sure I understand your question, but
maybe I need to restate what I thought you just said. I thought what you said is that we don't need to consider the AC value for the torsion because the formula already
correct accounts for it
with the 3. But we would be using that same value for steady loads.
Steady loads don't have any KC value. Steady loads don't cause fatigue failure. So all these endurance limit modifying factors only apply to dynamic loading. So for static loading, you're fine just using your von Mises criteria, right? For dynamic loading, you're fine using your von Mises criteria, but in addition, we want to be a little more sophisticated about it, and we say, oh, and the dynamic axial load actually does more fatigue damage to our shaft than a bending load and a torque load, and we reflect that in these parameters. The 3 from the von Mises, or you could get rid of the 3 and divide it by 0.59 squared. That would be the same thing. The 0.85 for the axial load, and then we divide by 1 for bending, right? Because KC is 1 for bending. Does that make sense? Okay, there were more questions, let's address those too.
Mine's kind of the same thing. I don't understand when to use the KC value, because I figure you'd have to use that, but I have the same question. We're using a KC for torsion when it's steady, but then later on.
No. We don't use a KC if it's steady. If it's steady, there's never a KC.
But if we look at the 3 is in there for the first example, the 3 is in there for steady, but then the next example.
Oh, I see where the confusion is coming from right now. I see what you're saying. Yes, okay, so in that sense, you use Yes, you use the von Mises criterion that says shear stresses do more damage than normal stresses. That's why there's the three. And that's true for steady as well as dynamic loading. So in both cases, yes, now I understand why we're in the previous one. Alright, so if you do a steady stress and use the von Mises criterion, that three is there always. You can't drop that. That's just that's the definition of the criteria that you're using. When we're dealing with dynamic loading, first of all, we don't use KC very often because we always have cases of combined loading. And if we have combined loading, then we say KC is equal to 1. So essentially, you could imagine there being a KC here, it's just equal to 1. And what we do is we're more sophisticated about it. We say we account for the difference in damage that the type of loading does in terms of fatigue by dividing by the appropriate factors. Okay? Does that make sense now? If you were to not, and you can see that this is true, if you were to now say I have only axial loading, then this component would be there, that component would be there. I took my KC is equal to 1, but I'm still dividing this by 0.85. So this is going to go, 0.85 is going to go into the numerator, and it's going to have exactly the same effect as taking KC is equal to 0.85 here. You see that? No? It seems arbitrary to account for it. Let me try again. All right, so let's say we have pure dynamic axial loading, right? We have pure dynamic axial loading. That's one of those rare cases where we could say KC is equal to 0.85. Okay, do you agree with that? All right. So if we say KC is equal to 0.85, we're essentially multiplying sigma E prime with 0.85. We apply it to all loading components. But we only have axial loading here, so it's only to the axial component. So it goes into our calculation of sigma E. Now compare that to the case where we say, let's say we by default we say KC is always equal to 1, even in cases of pure axial loading. And we'll always account for that component on our Mises criterion. So what we then do is we have now a case of still pure axial dynamic loading. So this term goes, that term goes away. So this is what we're left with, right? We divide it by 0.85. Now this is going to be our sigma A prime. We put this into sigma A prime, and the 0.85 is going to go to the numerator, and we're essentially multiplying sigma E, where we had first accounted for with KC equal to 1, we're multiplying it with 0.85, and we're in the end still doing the same thing. We're still multiplying that term with 0.85. Right? So for pure loading, it doesn't really matter. Simple loading, it doesn't really matter whether you take the KC equal to 1 there or whether you account for it here. It doesn't matter when you have combined loading, because if you then take the KC equal to 0.85 here, you're applying it to all your stress components because it goes into sigma E. If you apply it in sigma A prime, then you can specifically apply it to the right stress component.
Does it not matter, like, is it outside of the square theorem, or also get the square?
Is it what?
Never mind, just go on.
are you wondering whether the 0.85 is part of the square?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's underneath the square, right? So you just divide this component by 0.85, you superimpose it with that guy, and then you square it because that's part of your von Mises criterion. Yes.
When will we use
whoever
KC equals 0.59?
If you have a case of pure torque, and it would be the same story, if you have a case of pure torque, you know, all of this would go away, and you could do two things. You could say, I'm either going to set KC equal to 0.59, and then I'm going to, then I don't need to do my von Mises criterion, I'm just going to use the shear stress, directly in my failure criterion, or I'm going to say KC is equal to 1, and I account for the 0.59 in my criteria here, right? Because if I do, I could do tau A divided by 0.59 squared, and then it's almost equal to 3. Okay? Yeah.
So if I'm following this right, basically, in our Von Mises criterion, it's the sum of our sigma